Hi, I'm Linda Boutwal, and today I'm going to speak about my research about the metal worker and their tool. The Irish Bronze Age has yielded some of the most magnificent gold ornaments and bronze artifacts in Europe. Some lunula, as you can see on the picture on the right, are made from a sheet less than 0.5 mm thick. The manufacture of ribbon torque requires a perfect knowledge of the mechanical capacity of gold. We have the ribbon torque on the center. This object often testifies to technical prowess that is still not easy to reproduce even today. The Irish Bronze Age metalwork also illustrates the perfect knowledge of metalworking and the incredible creativity of the Irish metalworker. However, while we know pretty well how they were made, we have no idea who made them. Many theories have been proposed, but none have been unanimously accepted. For example, some researchers think that the metallurgists were itinerant craftsmen, while, of course, some others think the contrary, seeing them rather a craftsman residing permanently in a place and producing for the elite in place. Some suggest that they were professional, and some others suggest that they were not. In this talk, I'm not going to explain how the artifacts were made and how the Irish metal workers were exceptional, but I'm going to focus on the tools they made and they have used, and how they can help us to understand who the Irish metal workers were. But before that, we have to understand that during the Bronze Age, the metal worker mostly used two main techniques, casting metal and plastic deformation. Casting metal consists of pouring the molten metal around 1100 degrees for bronze into a mold bearing the imprint of the desired object, as you can see on the three pictures on the screen. At its cool, the metal will solidify and retain the shape of the imprint. On the screen, you can see a mold for a socket axis, spiral, and sword. This technique produces massive objects, including axes, sword, dagger, knife, tool, and ornament. The mold can be made of stone on the center of the picture, clay on the right, and metal on the left, and even cuttlefish bone. A distinction is made between reusable mold, stone metal, and single-use mold, fire clay, which is broken when the metal object is extracted. They can produce individually cast objects, axe, sword, bread, or several small objects produced in group or cluster, often with a simple morphology than the former, rings, pendant, or bar. Sometimes, some mold even have a core that allow you to cast hollow socket. We can see two examples, the mold for axes and the mold for spearhead. The practice of plastic deformation consists in transforming a metal blank, a solid object obtained by casting, into a thin sheet a few millimeters thick via a succession of hammering and annealing phases. By hammering, the craftsman hardens the metal, which as a consequence becomes brittle. Annealing consists of passing the metal over a fire to restore its plasticity. Often the fire is 300 degrees. Thus, starting from a flat blank, the craftsman, blow after blow, will stretch, refine the blank, and shape the object. This technique will therefore produce much lighter objects than casted objects. It is often used for ornament, vessel, and more rarely defensive weapon, like helmet or armor. The tool used in the context of plastic deformation consists of hammer and striking support, which are most commonly called anvil. They are used to give the desired shape to an object. The hammer and anvil can be in metal, but also in stone or in wood. You can see on the picture a French horde, which regroupe several objects used for plastic deformation. In the middle of the picture, you can see a stone object. This object is extremely important. It is a stone hammer made from a stone axis. The cutting edge of this axe has been polished for making a flat, regular, and polished surface and used for hammering. It shows an extremely interesting phenomenon of recycling of objects to make new ones. Around 180 hammers from stone axes are now in France. Metalworker tools can be found in several different contexts, like settlement, hoard, engrave, but also as single finds. That's why they offer a complete view of the society to which they belong or its organization. However, tools related to plastic deformation and tools related to casting do not normally occur in the same context. They are extremely rarely found together. The same is true for tools of different materials. Some stone tools, metal tools, or clay tools do not occur together in the same context, or are extremely rare. For example, metal tools are almost never discovered in the context of dwelling or burial, and are only present in the context of hoard. Sometimes they are also found as a single find. In the same way, stone wool are never found with a metal tool in hoard. There are hoard with stone casting wool, and hoard with metal tool. Genelard is a hoard found in France around 1975, so it's a recent discovery, and we know that the hoard is complete. Genelard is composed of several tools used for metal working and other artifacts, such as spearhead, pins, which seem to belong to a man, and knife also. It is the most complete metalworker equipment that we know in the Europe Bronze Age. That's why it's a very important discovery. It shows us what a Bronze Age metalworker toolset looks like. There are a set of three hammers, potentially a force, a stone hammer made from a stone axis, at least two different kinds of anvil, here and here, a set of punch for decoration, here and probably also here, a set of triboulet used for making rings, a stone abrasive tool, a metal mould for rings, and some tracing tool and some ring. Genelard is also extremely important because it shows that stone and metal hammer could be used within the same tool set. In Ireland, metal tools such as hammer and anvil used for metal work here are extremely rare in hoard and occur mainly at the end of the Bronze Age. We know only four hoard with metal working tools in Ireland. We do not have any metal tool for the earliest phase of the Bronze Age. For the hammer, for example, they could take on the appearance of flat metal flat axis with a flat edge. But we have also to imagine, and we know also, stone hammer made from stone axis, also with a flat edge. As we will see in Ireland, the metal worker tool set found in hoard are less complete than in Genelard, for example. Bishop lamp in Kildare is probably the most complete toolset known used by metal worker in Ireland. The hoard has been found in 1942 during a work on a steep slope above a river. Unfortunately, it was quickly dispersed, so it's probably not complete. It includes three different socket hammers of different size. So probably with different uses, a possible vis, a miniature anvil with three work surface on a steam, presumably for insertion into a block of wood. A small anvil like this would probably have been used for delicate work like making ornaments or gold working. The gold also include two rings, a sickle blade, a tool set of chisel and saw, a simple flesh hook, presumably used for hooking meat from a boiling cauldron or a cooking pit, and two different axes. Due to the fact that the ode is incomplete, it's obviously difficult to interpret. However, the size of the tool and mostly the anvil suggest a goldsmith tool set, or at least a tool set for making small ornaments. The hook suggests the practice of feasting and perhaps community feasting. So we have in this ode the association between the practice of metallurgy and possibly goldsmithing and the practice of community feasting, and we'll see that it might be not anecdotic. Nothing is certain about this ode. For example, we don't know the exact circumstance of the discovery. The ode includes two hammers, two chisels, one gouge, one stone tool, one small, extremely small anvil, used probably for folding a tiny piece of metal sheet, and also making ring on this part, and two unidentified objects. The object differ in external appearance, and also the patina is different, which might suggest they have been different origins and do not form an homogeneous whole. And the ode seems to be a collection of different objects from different origins. However, as we have seen with the previous ode, the metal working tool set is coherent. The size of the anvil and both hammers also suggest a tool set used for tiny objects, like goldsmithing and small ornaments. The presence of an abrasive tool might be quite unusual also for a fake to ode. It's not normally an object that you add when you want to make a ode. So what do we know about the tool from Hord? To sum up, metalworker tools are rare in Ireland, like in Europe mostly. And for example, in France, are specific to the western part, the Atlantic facade. So it seems that some societies do not put metalworker tools in their Hord. The tool set from Hord could be a way to highlight a special activity and so a way to recognize the special tattoo of the craftsman. The tools are quite exclusively metal tools for plastic deformation. Due to the fact that the discoveries are quite old and it was common to only keep the metal object, some stone tools might not have been preserved in metal ord. Stone tool might be abrasive tool, but also tool for plastic deformation like anvil or hammer. But there is no mix between metal tool and stone or clay casting tool, for example. The size of the tool seems to suggest tool for making ornament and or goldsmithing. Bishopsland ord could also suggest a kind of association between metallurgy and community feasting. Metalworker tools are not exclusively found within metal ord. We know across Europe several sets of tools made exclusively with stone casting wool, and which form an unusual kind of ord. We know in Ireland 16 of them, included four that we don't have a precise origin and one with an uncertain provenance. The first ord seems to appear during the Homa period, but indeed the phenomenon mostly occurs during the Kilimadi phase, so between 1600 and 1400 BC. This phenomenon is its end contemporary to the Bishopsland phase and the metalworker tool set ode. Alors, we have a stark contrast between the metal ode, which mostly consists of heterogeneous assemblage of metal objects, but can occasionally also include non-metal objects, and the casting mold ode, which mostly and exclusively include casting mold. Also, in this ord, the presence of bolt valve is different from the remain of a workshop where most of the bivalve mold are both incomplete, unbroken. The Ogma Horde is the earliest horde of this phenomenon in Ireland. It includes 5 stone molds, except for one, the molds are complete, which means 2 valves. All the molds are made from the same stone, in this case a muscovite. It seems that we have a homogeneous toolset for casting different kinds of spearhead, some blade and a possible anvil that we cannot see very well. But no axe or no ornaments such as ring. Alors, this horde is probably one of the most breathtaking stone casting molds across Europe. It's a real piece of art and it shows the high level skill of the carver. The horde is one mold with its 2 valves. So you have the first valve here and the second valve here. The mold has 4 negatives on each face of the valve used to produce dirt, but the production of all the objects cannot be simultaneous. In certain cases, in the horde, the mold may have been designed with multiple negative forms from the beginning, but in some other cases, it's possible also that some negatives were added later. In Ireland, 9 hordes include only a single mold, and 7 assemblages consist of more than 2 complete molds. The horde has been found during the ploughing during the early 20th century. The molds are used for casting different types of spearhead, dirk, daggers, and knife, and sickle. There are also one abrasive tool and one stone anvil. The horde include 2 molds in steatite here and several molds in sandstone. It's notable that both steatite molds are complete, it means with their 2 valves, while except for the sickle, only a single valve is present for the sandstone mold. It gives the impression that we have here 2 different sets of molds, one in steatite and one in sandstone. Another important point to notice is while Bishopland was probably a tool set for making ornament with metal sheet by plastic deformation, this horde is more a tool set for casting weapon and tool. Also, the dihedral work surface of the anvil could be used for sharpening blade by hammering, and the abrasive tool could have been used to finish the sharpening of blade. So it seems to be a complete tool set for someone who aims to produce weapon, blade, and tool. To finish, the mold from Moylisha was discovered at the base of a mound. Both valves were positioned one against the other. The horde from Tourglass was brought to light by Anthony Conmy while he was plugging. The horde from Balido was probably encountered in a bog. Both horde from Moylisha and Balido correspond to an individual mold used to produce a spearhead and for Balido a socket axe. Tourglass is incomplete and made from steatite. It corresponds to 2 different molds with only 1 valve for each. Stone casting mold horde corresponds to an unusual kind of horde that a lot of people still ignore. They show that during the Bronze Age, the horde were only made up of metal objects, and so the phenomenon of Bronze Age horde is more complex than often we believe. They mostly and exclusively consist of casting mold, so it suggests that they may belong to a craftsman. But it also suggests that both metal ord and stone casting wool ord were two different practices. They occur mainly during the Kilimani phase and before the Bishopsland phase. They seem not to be strictly contemporaneous, which metalworker toolset found in metal ord. However, metal ord were already a regular practice during the Kilimani phase. They are used stone casting mold, are used for casting weapons and tools, more rarely axe or ring, while metalworker ord are mainly focused on tools for plastic deformation and sheet metal working. So it suggests that both casting and plastic deformation sheet metal working were two separate practices, possibly not practiced by the same craftsman. Some tools are also from settlement and so can give the possibility to identify workshop. We know around 18 late Bronze Age settlements with evidence of metalworking across Ireland. These sites have different statuts: hill fort, domestic dwelling, lake platform, or what we call ritual structure. They mostly yielded clay mold, crucible, bass metal, stone tool, or metal object. Logger is the first and the only site where Bronze Age domestic activity could be linked to metallurgical activity. The site shows an occupation range from the Neolithic up to the medieval period. The metallurgical activities are attested in two areas, D and F. You can see the plan on the screen. The site D is a group of three houses, but only house one yield remains of metallurgy. House one consists of a huge foundation of stone block. On excavation, 10 clay mold fragments were found just outside and to the north of the house one. 6 of these fragments were fitted together to form a mold for casting spearheads. 2 other fragments form a mold for casting past slab. Fragments of crucible were also found on the site. The site F is the other metalworking area at Logger. Site F consists of a rectangular house foundation with the interior of the house was roughly covered in the same manner as Ouse 1. A large hearth was centrally placed with another lying straightly to the northwest. These were associated with spread of charcoal. A trapezoidal pit close the second hearth may be connected to the metallurgical activities and used to hold the mold upright. Some clay mold for casting spearheads and rapiers, as well as some vast bronze casting were uncovered nearby the site F. Logger shows that metalworking mostly casting objects like spearhead and axes was practiced in domestic settlement. So the site shows that casting objects could be a part of domestic activity and maybe household level production. But there is no trace of metal tool, they might have been recycled or present or not present at all. So no Razgal. Razgal had been excavated in the early 70s by Barry Raftery, and consists on a multi-valve stone fort situated in the shoulder of the ridge. The inner stone rampart, so here, appear to be medieval, while the massive bank and ditch defense could be from the late Bronze Age. The late Bronze Age activity seemed to come mostly from a circular house at the center of the complex, mostly here. However, the metalworking evidence came from an occupation immediately outside the ditch. This occupation horizon was a deposit of black humid material, 35 cm deep, and associated with the area of combling on a rectangular spread of charcoal, and it has been interpreted as a hearth. These were accompanied by a large number of post holes. Although the full extent of this element of the complex was never really uncovered. This has been interpreted as a timber built structure of impressive dimension, Barbary Raftery. Over 2000 clay wood fragments for casting swords, spearhead, axe, gouges, among others, were recovered along with many crucibles. The majority were found in the western end of the structure, adjacent to the crumbling of vast production, clearly indicating a casting operation of vast proportion. From also came some gouges, conical rivets, bar toggles, and a small hoard consisting of a chisel and a part of a sword and spearhead. This small hoard could come from a funerary context, which is extremely rare. Metallurgical activity were not confined to the hilltop, and some other tests outside the defense uncovered settlement in the form of several post-built structures, and among the finds were a small number of clay wool fragments. So the quantity of metalworking evidence at Rasgal is unparalleled in Ireland and other and in Europe in general, and suggests the evidence of centralized metalwork production on a large scale. In the world of Barry Raftery, the impression form is thus of a large industrial complex spreading over an area of considerable size, with a workshop at its center and the open air hearths clustered around it. Rasgal show metallurgy mostly focus on casting even if some tool might be used for plastic deformation. We have probably between some other three stone tools with one probably small hammer. It shows that metallurgy took place on a larger scale within some defended site often called hill fort. The huge quantity of casting wool could suggest that metallurgy could take place during events that brought the community together and involved several different persons. This site is also a multi-valad stone fort situated on a cliff edge. The excavation took place from 1992 to 1994 as a part of the Discovery Program research led by Claire Cotter. The excavation produced a clear evidence of late Bronze Age occupation and other activities, including metalworking. However, the contemporaneity of the activity on the defensive system remain unclear. Several roughly circular hut sites marked by a low stone wall and featuring area of stone paving were uncovered in the interior of the site. The hut one was the best preserved. Its excavation revealed three pre-hut occupation settlement horizons below the structure with no gap, and late Bronze Age radiocarbon date range from 1375 BC to 906 BC. Hundreds of clay mool and crucible fragments were found in each of the three layers. They have been used for producing sword, ping, spearhead, and bracelet. Some bronze artifacts, such as a bracelet, the head of a small chisel, and a ping chang fragment, have also been discovered. Interestingly, the bracelet seems to have been cast from a clay wood fragment, which has been found on the site. A huge quantity of bone remains suggests that some kind of feasting occurred on the site. To sum up, the site shows the discovery of a large quantity of casting refuse without structural evidence. Like at Rasgal, it seems to show a vast casting operation mostly for the production of sword and spearhead. This vast casting operation seems to have occurred with a practice of feasting involving meat consumption and also at a large scale. As you might remember, we have already the association of metallurgy and feasting with the Bishop's Land Hoard. I don't need to introduce the King's Table and the Navan Complex, but maybe not everybody is from Northern Ireland. So the King's Table are a part of the Navan complex of a monument. The complex lie in a drumlin belt, with the site situating on a low ridge, 100 meters north of a bog. The ridge is surmounted by the large late Bronze Age enclosure known as Hoggy Fort that we will see soon after the King's Table. The King's Table consists of a second hollow containing a seasonal variable depth of water surrounded by a peninsular bank. The central hollow is 25 meters in diameter, and the top of the bank is 3 to 4 meters above the scarp of the pool edge. There is a gap, apparently original, in the bank on the west of the site. A trial excavation in 1975 saw two trenches across the bank on most of the central hollow when the water level was extremely low. No structural evidence was uncovered. The evidence for metallurgy was limited to 18 clay mould fragments recovered from the central bassin and mostly in two layers, which appear to be deposited, dumped into the pool near its edge. The excavator said that it is reasonably certain that the material containing animal bone and clay mould fragments was introduced deliberately no longer after the monument was constructed. As the clay mould came from a narrow trench and constituted only a very small part of the overall circumference, we might reasonably expect that it's at other points around the edge of the pool and possibly in a large quantity. The animal and human bone remains suggest a ritual or ceremonial purpose for this unusual site. The presence of mould in the pool may also be of ritual significance, rather than a purely secular act of refuse, for example. We have to be aware that the deposition of metallurgical material at ritual site in the Bronze Age is a current feature of the Irish archaeological record, unless in some other country, like in France, par exemple. It is possible that the mould from the King's Table originated from Hoggy Fort, which uncovered evidence for gold and bronze metalworking and also festing. Both sites yet the same kind of pottery and are contemporaneous. Hoggy Fort is a part of the Navan complex and its offer included within the class 2 of the typology of the hill fort. The fort was trivalve. Several seasons of excavation have revealed evidence of occupation during 1300 to 900 BC. I'm not going through the detail, but the excavation of the ditch on the interior of the site yielded several scraps of gold and bronze and fragments of objects which suggest the practice of gold and bronze working. But no tool has been found yet. However, the study of the gold scraps shows the practice of goldsmithing, while the study of bronze droplets shows mostly the practice of casting. So, Hoggy Fort can be without doubt a site with an extremely high statue, where festing and metalworking were in association. The presence of goldsmithing is exceptional and unique, probably across Europe. On the late Bronze Age settlement, metallurgical activity seemed to be illustrated with the clay mould, bronze craft, and sometimes some stone tool. There is no trace of metal tool. They might have been recycled or not present at all. They might have been considered as a personal item, and not left on the site. It could suggest that metal tools were not the most common tool used by metal workers and could correspond to a tool set used by specialists, like a goldsmith, for example. The metallurgical activity seemed to take place in a different kind of site, enclosed settlement, lake platform, ritual site, structure showing that metallurgical activity may take place within different contexts, domestic, ritual, and ceremonial. Also, there is a clear evidence of metalworking, the nature of this activity is unclear. There is no, for example, evidence for spatial organization and for the structure utilized. this absence may suggest that the structure like a pit furnace, as we imagine, may be indeed different, and also that metallurgy might be not an everyday activity. Rasgall and Dunagan seems to suggest the existence of centralized bronze production on a large scale, but for probably a short time. This large centralized production seems also to focus on a large casting activities, and there are few indications of plastic deformation, which might be during a ceremonial event like festine. A metalworker grave is a grave containing tool used for metalworking. We know around 500 graves in Europe, ranging from the late Neolithic to the late Bronze Age. But there are also graves during the Iron Age and also during the medieval period, so it's not specific to the Bronze Age. However, these graves are rare in all periods and cultures. They never form the norm of a burial practice. As you can see, their distribution is uneven in Europe. For example, they are known in Poland, but completely unknown in Ireland. So what I'm going to talking about them, because they might suggest that the social status of the metal worker was recognized in some regions, but not in all of them. But the most important thing is that metal worker graves is an extremely complex phenomenon. So the first grave that I'm going to talk about is São Pedro de Estoril in Portugal. The grave is from an hypogeum and contains, among other objects, two stones probably used as hammer for metalworking, here and here, with several gold ornaments, some gold spiral, and other prestigious items. This grave suggests high status. Of course, we don't know who was the owner of the grave, and if the presence of tool indicates the activity of the owner. It could be, for example, an artisan. The grave suggests that some artisan had a high status in Portuguese Bellbaker Society. The grave goods seem to suggest a high status, so it could suggest that metallurgy was a kind of knowledge only shared across the elite of Bellbaker Society. The presence of the tool could also be purely symbolic and not illustrate the activity of the person buried. We know in some African societies, for example, kings with metalworker tool as a regalia, but who don't practice metallurgy themselves. Alors, the grave of the Amesbury Archer is the richest Bellbaker's grave across UK and Ireland. The grave belonged to a 40-year-old man buried with a lot of grave goods, such as some copper dagger, flint arrowhead, bear tusk, here and here, gold ornament, I don't find the gold ornament, and unusual black stone, here. Some analyses have shown that some of these were from the western part of Germany, like the blast stone. The stone does not seem to have been used as a hammer on anvil, and its function remains enigmatic. It has been suggested that it could be a touchstone used to test the quality of gold, and so this man could be a goldsmith. So the grave from Los Cipreses belonged to a 40-year-old man who had been buried with a halberd, two daggers, and a tool set for metal working, with two hammer anvil, pardon, and a kind of polisher. For this society to whom this might belong, these are very wealthy grave goods, and this man was probably a member of the upper class of the society. The tool set, so as I say, is composed with two hammer anvil. Both objects can be used as hammer anvil, and a big abrasive tool. The exact function of the hammer are difficult to establish. They could have been used for sharpening the blade, for example. And so, with the abrasive tool, this tool set could be a tool set used for maintaining the different blades. In Central Europe, we know graves containing stone casting mould. Some graphs contain a single mole, while some others contain several, like this graph. They are often called founder graphs because the Metalworker toolset is only composed of casting mole, like the Horde. The particularity of this graph is that a razor seems to have been cast in one of the mole, as you can see here. These graves are also extremely simple. There is no indication of high statue which suggests that this person were probably among the normal persons in the Late Bronze Age society. The last grave is from Pulz in Germany and it's attributed to the Late Bronze Age. The grave goods include a sword, an axe, a hammer, pottery, and some other objects linked to the sword. This grave shows a high statue, but not the highest in this society. The Metalworker toolset is composed of a metal hammer with a dihedral working surface. This kind of hammer can be used, for example, as a hammer used for sharpening blades, like the two anvil hammers that we have seen in the Spanish grave. So we could consider this grave as an artisan grave, or maybe consider that this grave corresponds to the grave of the sword bearer who need to maintain his sword, exactly like the Spanish grave. So within the grave, the tool can be installed, more rarely in metal and extremely rarely in clay. Depending on the period, on the area, these graves can contain toolset for casting metal, while some others are often for plastic deformation. They are never mixed, and often the tools seem to have been used, suggesting that they are functional. It could illustrate two different specialisms. However, we have seen that the phenomenon of metalworker grave is extremely complex and could correspond to different phenomena across different periods and society. Some graves could belong to artisans, but some others seem to belong to the elite, while in some other graves, the presence of metalworker toolset could be purely symbolic. Indirectly, it could also suggest that metalworking could place in a different context, some probably domestic and some other perhaps ceremonial or ritual. A single find is an artifact found outside a well-defined context and often perceived as a loss for archaeology and for science. For the Bronze Age, the tools found without context are often stone tools, mold, hammer, anvil, and metal tools, mostly hammer. Stone hammer and anvil are rarely found in the well-defined context, so more attention should be taken to study the lithic tool from excavation. So an important part of the metalworker toolset remains unknown if we do not study the single find. The study of stone tools found during excavation and the identification of tools used by metalworkers could give us the possibility to recognize the workshop without any trace of metal. During the Bronze Age, stone hammer used by metalworker could be made from stone axe with a polished flat surface instead of the cutting edge. The anvil are often made from a parallelepiped stone block and often perfectly polished on several faces. The shape of the face can be flat, but also convex, and sometimes dihedral. We must imagine this block put into a wooden block on the metalworker using the different faces following his need. The size of the tool is often quite small, unlike the metal tool, more suitable for working small pieces of sheet and making ornaments. It's difficult, for example, to do some, it's difficult and quite impossible to do some vessel on this kind of tool. Here are two other hammers from stone axes, both show different sizes on two different work surfaces, suggesting distinct functions across the process of manufacturing ornament. However, this kind of tool is too light for the manufacture of cauldron. There were certainly other tools used by metal workers that we still ignore. So what have we learned from the study of the metalworker's tool? During the Bronze Age, the tools were made from metal, but also in stone, clay, probably wood, even horn. It suggests a perfect knowledge on mechanical capacity of the metal, which is also illustrated by the virtuosity of the Irish metal worker. Metal production could take place in domestic dwelling as well as high status site or ritual site, suggesting that the practice of metallurgy could have different purposes. It seems possible that feasting and casting bronze were practiced on some occasion together. But the association between feasting and the practice of metallurgy could suggest that at some stage, several persons, maybe craftsmen, were practicing vast casting operations together, mostly to produce weapons like swords and spears. We could also suggest that during this festivity, like the meat, some weapons were distributed among the guests. The place of the metal worker in Bronze Age society is difficult to determine. From the Grave, it seems that some society have at some stage expressed the need to highlight the practice of metallurgy by adding metal workers' tools as a grave goods for people with different social status. From the Irish data, we could have at the same time specialists, goldsmiths, sheet workers, and domestic producers, but the need to express that within the grave does not appear. It suggests an Irish Bronze Age society more complex than we sometimes believe. We probably still ignore a lot of tools, and future research should focus on the study of stone assemblage from the excavation. Many thanks for your attention.